يحلو كلما كررته ولذاك عدت مكررا لحلاوته.
السلام عليكم. I have the pleasure to be here with you for the first time for my between my brothers and sisters. I'm Dr. Afi Shafi, I'm assistant consultant in neonatology, National Guard Hospital, Riyadh. I have two lectures today. First one I'll present now about the adjuvant therapy or the medications. And second lecture, inshallah, we'll talk about the vet.
So, we'll start now with the medical therapists commonly we are using in neonatal intensive care. Whenever they call us in liver and liver room about small day coming, we're going to prepare ourselves anticipating the problems we are going to face. So we're preparing our mechanical detox incubation set, we're preparing Sylvanta, our medication, concerning antibiotics, research on central lines, and we might encounter some other problems. Patient may be agitated, we're going to use some sedation for him, maybe an analgesia. Patient may develop some other complications, that's how we're going to deal with. While we are thinking in all this dilemma, we should not forget one of the very important things in our management for small babies, which is nutrition. Because we are just got overwhelmed and busy about our intensive care management and so on, we are not concerned too much about nutrition, which is quite important, especially for small babies, microprenates. As patients start to pass into the metabolic stage, that will be very difficult to catch up with. That's why we have to put in consideration the caloric intake and food supplementation for such to be from first hour after admission. And think about supplementation of total parenteral nutrition for such kids. And again, later on in life, if the patient develops some chronic lung disease, and so we have to put in consideration again the more caloric intake patients actually need for. About the energy requirement in such babies, we know about the requirement variable nearly around 100
kilocalorie per kg per day. This is under basic. I mean, this is a basic requirement. They might increase a little bit. For example, if the patient on full enteral intake, if the patient is fighting the ventilator or he develops the chronic lung disease, caloric requirements usually increase a little bit more, even by 20, by 40 even kilocalorie per kg per day. If the patient on parenteral intake, the caloric intake usually a little bit lower than this one. And we can achieve this goal through total parenteral nutrition initially, and later on with the introduction of enteral intake, we can just use high caloric intake formulas with advancement of the caloric intake reaching up to even 1 kilocalorie per 1 ml in special formulas. Also some vitamins like vitamin A with antioxidant effect will put in consideration. Now we'll go to our one of the very important medication, one of the best evidence-based medication in neonatology, the surfactant. Actually the first time to be discovered 2019-47, and the first time to be implemented and to be used in NICU as a therapy for respiratory distress syndrome, it was in 1980. As we know, the mode of action of surfactant, surfactant action mainly working by decreasing surface tension, meaning increasing surface area of the alveoli, and preventing the alveoli to collapse, especially during the phase of expiration. Surfactant produced by type 2 alveolar cells and stored what's called lamellar bodies and consists of this concentric or parallel lamellae. Surfactant is composed mainly of phospholipids. This is the general structure of surfactant, mainly of the phosphatidylcholine or phospholipids, either saturated or unsaturated, and the protein part, either protein A, B, C, and D, and it's very important. Some of this protein deficiency in development of severe RDS, which cannot manage with surfactant replacement. There are two types of surfactant, as we know. First one is the natural surfactant, which is more or less commonly used or favorably used. And second one is the synthetic surfactant. So the disease slide shows different types actually of the natural surfactant. Maybe one of the very famous is the Cervanta. It's the commons you are using. Some units are using the PureSurf, and maybe others, depending on the familiarity of each one. Synthetic surfactant, different types also. Maybe one of the famous one is the ExoSurf, and different other different modalities. It's actually some of the trials is published in Pediatric 2008 about the surfactant replacement therapy for the dysplastic syndrome, preterm and term babies. Surfactant either given as prophylaxis, I mean before the development of the signs of dysplastic stress syndrome, just from first beginning after delivery, or as rescue once the patient starts to manifest, either as early rescue once the first hour or later on late rescue therapy. It reduces the incidence of severity of dysplastic stress syndrome, air leak, development of pneumothorax and so, as well as the mortality in preterm babies with RDS or dysplastic stress syndrome surfactant deficiency. Both animal derived, this is the natural surfactant, or the synthetic surfactant, decrease the morbidity and mortality in preterm infant with surfactant patients. Here, the surfactant replacement has not been shown to affect the incidence of neurologic, developmental, or behavioral medical education outcome in preterm infants. Very safe medication. We have expected after the year of surfactant to decrease the incidence of BBD or bronchopulmonary dysplasia, but unfortunately it's kept the same, especially in preterm babies less than 30 weeks. The picture may be a little bit different in those who are more than 30 weeks, but more or less the incidence of BBD is still nearly the same. Surfactant again, one of the advantages, increased oxygenation, reducing the need for the ECMO or other advanced modalities of the treatment of persistent or severe hypoxia, without increasing the morbidity of neonates. In neonates, with again with some other syndromes like meconium aspiration syndrome, sepsis, with pneumonia, especially GBS pneumonia. Surfactant may also reduce the mortality and morbidity with pulmonary hypertension. Actually, there is no strong evidence to use Cervanta in or surfactant in meconium aspiration or pulmonary hypertension, but still we are using. There is no strong evidence to be used, and still some debate about the use surfactant to be a part of protocol in the hospital. For example, in our unit we are using, still we are using, give very good results actually, but evidence-based per se is not evidence-based till now. I don't know if you have some experience here with iron. No. Anyway, it's very one of the very important medication, especially in complicated cases. Sometimes we are faced with some babies with intractable hypoxia, and especially a case of meconium aspiration syndrome, for example. And we found some shunting with right left shunt and intractable hypoxia there, and actually we just got stuck. We are ventilating the babies, giving him surfactant, for example, putting him conventional ventilators. Conventional ventilator is failing, we shift to oscillator, high frequency ventilator. Still, the patient is cyanosed and hypoxic with marked difference in pre and postductal saturation. And to confirm the picture of PPHN, we just go to echocardiography and show or diagnose persistent pulmonary hypertension. Actually, one of the best tried medication and it changes the outcome dramatically is the inhaled nitric oxide. The advantage of neonatal nitric oxide, if compared to other anti-pulmonary hypertensive medication we used to use in the past, it is very selective and acting mainly in the pulmonary vascular bed. Other medications can cause actually vasodilatation somewhere else in the body and can produce intractable systemic hypotension and we start again the dilemma of using vasopressors and inotropes and so and volume replacement even. So it's very selective pulmonary vasodilator neonatal nitric oxide without any effect or significant effect on stem circulation and decreasing the right-left shunting. Nitric oxide, it is naturally formed gas in our bodies and mechanism of action, it relaxes the smooth muscle actually by activating the guanylate cyclase enzyme. The guanylate cyclase enzyme, I'll show the next slide how it works, actually working by changing or increasing the level of cyclic GMP or 3 and 5 cyclic guanosine monophosphate. Guanosine monophosphate actually can stimulate another enzyme and through the activation of this enzyme will decrease the level of intracellular calcium. Decreasing the calcium will act on the myosin and adenine and so eventually resulting in the reduction of the spasm of the smooth muscles of the arterioles in the pulmonary vascular bed, result of pulmonary vasodilatation and decrease the pulmonary hypertension. Nitric oxide is indicated for the treatment of term, mainly term babies, and sometimes near-term babies, but more or less more than 34 weeks. There's no evidence to use inhaled nitric oxide in preterm babies. Again, our unit, we are using nitric oxide in preterm babies, and it got some effect, but again, this is not evidence-based. We can titrate the dose of nitric oxide. It depends upon the protocol of different unit. In our unit, usually we start with 20 parts per million, generally speaking, and most of the time we are just kept or fixed to this level. Some units actually can go up to even 40 parts per million. It depends upon the outcome. The onset of action is dramatic, within few seconds even. The effect of nitric oxide starts to work, and you can see just dramatic improvement in saturation immediately, actually, after starting. And once there's no improvement, unlikely to improve later on. It is expensive stuff, actually, and I think in UK they are just supplying it free for the first maybe 24 hours or something like this, and later on they start to count by hours how much it will cost. So it's expensive stuff, actually. Once we reach the acceptable saturation of the baby, we start thinking about to wean, and weaning process should be a very gradual process, because once you start to give nitric oxide from outside, we are going to depress the endogenous production of nitric oxide, right? So it will, body per se will take some time to just wake up again and start to produce its own nitric oxide. So it should be very cautious and very gradual protocol of weaning from this nitric oxide. Because abrupt, as we are telling, abrupt or sudden cessation of supplementation of nitric oxide will cause intractable and maybe paradoxical hypotension and hypoxia, and maybe increasing pulmonary hypertension to an intractable level again. It should not be used in babies with congenital heart disease or duct-dependent right-left shunt, because we are not in need to reverse the shunt to be left-right. We are in need to keep it right-left shunt in duct-dependent systemic circulation, I mean, congenital heart disease. One of the drawbacks of we are not encountered actually in practice, we are not seeing too much about the methemoglobinemia. One of the causes we know for developing methemoglobinemia is the inhaled nitric oxide. With this level actually of 20 parts per million, unlikely to see the level of this high level methemoglobinemia, and will affect the baby. Usually it is a safe level. Some data have been published with nitric oxide about platelet aggregation, prolonged bleeding time, about the possibility of intraventricular hemorrhage or pulmonary hemorrhage. Actually, we are not seeing such complications with our practice with this nitric oxide. One of the things to be monitored during treatment with nitric oxide is the level of nitric dioxide and the level of methemoglobin as well. Actually, on the blood gas machine, we can either in the lab or the blood gas machine can supplement, can give us some clue or idea about the level of methemoglobin and sometimes about nitric oxide as well. So just to keep in mind all the time about the complications of nitric oxide, just not to use it in a free way like this. This slide showing this is endogenous endothelial cells about nitric oxide. The source is coming from this arginine. And here showing the how nitric oxide is working and acting on this enzyme, activating the guanidyl cyclase enzyme. This transforming what is GTP guanosine triphosphate to cycloguanosine 3 and 5 guanosine monophosphate. Guanosine monophosphate activating this enzyme, I'm telling about protein kinase enzyme. And this one decreasing the eventual outcome of this, the whole cycle is decreasing the intracellular calcium. And the calcium actually is very important in the contractions of muscles, even smooth muscles and so. So decreasing the calcium will cause relaxation of the vascular bed and producing this vasodilatation. Here in the same slide, we can see about another medication going into acting on the phosphodiesterase inhibitor enzyme, type 5, phosphodiesterase inhibitor is sildenafil, we're going to talk about. It's again the same about the nitric oxide, the activation of the guanidate cyclase enzyme, transforming GTP to GMP or cyclic GMP, and activating the protein kinase enzyme and eventually lowering the intravascular calcium and producing smooth muscle relaxation and vasodilation. It's the same here showing other different modalities of medication using nitric oxide. They are used in the past like prostacycline, some of the newer medication like nitric oxide, or one of the we are using actually this one day, nowadays working was called endothelin receptors, is the called bosentan, one of the medication used in the pulmonary hypertension. So again, the same mechanism of action as we said before about nitric oxide coming from arginine and increasing the level of cyclic regime. Here, phosphodiesterase inhibitors is sildenafil actually, or Viagra used to be used before by even oral medication. Phosphodiesterase type 5 is inhibitor. It actually acts by competitive inhibition for the phosphodiesterase type 5 and again increasing the level of cyclic MB and activating the same enzyme with decreasing intracellular calcium as well. Prostacycline acts by transformation of arachidonic acid to the prostaglandin I2 and increasing cyclic MB and eventually vasodilation. And about bosentan or insulin inhibitor acting by blocking the insulin receptors either type 1 or type 2. So the conclusion of this one is that inhaled nitric oxide improves systemic oxygenation in infant with persistent pulmonary hypertension and may reduce the need for more invasive treatment like ECMO and so. Other actually some of the potential or beneficial effects of nitric oxide rather than about the relaxation of pulmonary vascular bed and improvement of pulmonary hypertension. Nitric oxide can work on the lung parenchyma, on the bronchi and on the vasculature as well. Lung parenchyma can increase the growth, decrease the elastin production, decrease the inflammatory cascade and increasing even surfactant function. With the bronchi, producing bronchodilatation, decreasing the smooth muscle proliferation, and the vasculature increasing the relaxation, increasing the angiogenesis. Here the some studies are done showing the neurodevelopmental outcome when babies used to receive inhaled nitric oxide while they are in neonatal period, and showing actually no effect on the neurodevelopmental outcome at 2 years behavior or any medical problems at the age of 2 years. So it's safe medication for the time being to be used. The other second medication we are using, sometimes some units not having this inhaled nitric oxide, we can use other conventional medication for the pulmonary hypertension, is sildenafil. Some studies actually are done for the effect or beneficial effect of sildenafil and proven to be very effective and can be used by oral food. For sick patient, we can just install it through the OGT. And we are using actually in our unit again, either alone or a combination, usually after nitric oxide. Again, not every case is very responsive to nitric oxide, so we are using line by line, starting with inhaled nitric oxide if it failed or not giving very satisfactory result, we can shift to a second line like sildenafil, for example. Again, sildenafil is working here, acted by competitive inhibition or by phosphatidyl phosphodiesterase inhibitor type 5. And this one is, this enzyme is actually working to destroy cyclic GMP. Now when blocking this step, we're increasing again cyclic GMP, and again will increase the protease kinase enzyme, and again decreasing intracellular calcium and producing smooth muscle relaxation, and mainly on the palmar vascular bed. But again, systemic hypotension is a problem with sildenafil. We have to put in consideration. So we can start with actually some smaller dose, and gradually we can increase the dose, monitoring the blood pressure of the patient. And sometimes some babies are in need for volume replacement and even vasopressor or enteropathic support to keep the patient normal. Yes. It's actually some diagrammatic and diagrammatic representation of sildenafil. This is the black columns showing the oxygenation index after the use of sildenafil by hours. For example, this is 0.0. Is quite high for 6, 12, and even 36 hours, coming down less than 20 oxygen index. So actually improve this one, improving saturation as well. This black one showing sildenafil and gradually improving saturation after the use by hours again, and 6, 12, and after 24 hours, saturation pick up more than 90-95% after the use of sildenafil. Here, actually, third subject, we're going to talk about the analgesia, one of the adjuvant therapy for patients in intensive care units, as a pediatric intensive care unit, intensive care unit, the analgesia or the sedation with the patient on mechanical ventilation. Actually, this subject is a lot of debate and controversy is there about the use, either to use, not to use. I'm going to use it as a sedative. I'm going to use as analgesia. Is a patient need for sedation only, or just the need for painkiller? When to use, when not to use, what is the dose, how to wean, what are the complications, and so. So still actually under discussion and under trials till now, they use this sedation. Pain and its effect in the human unit, effect in the human and unit. Newborn does feel pain. There's not a creature who's not feeling pain. In noxious stimuli, putting the patient per se on a mechanical ventilator is very irritant thing, especially when we are doing some procedure more. Putting a tube in the trachea, especially with invasive ventilation, putting the indwelling catheter inside the trachea and doing suction is a very stressful event for every baby. Putting central lines and even sometimes surgical procedures is very painful. And pain, we know that affects the outcome later even in life. Anatomical and functional components, perception of pain is present in the human newborn. He does feel pain. Neurochemical systems are functional. Physiological changes are associated with pain, there are behavioral changes associated with pain, and there's memory of pain. So we should not neglect that this small creature is just not feeling, is not moving, is not crying, does not mean he is not feeling pain. This is the point we're talking about. Either we're going to just sedate the baby. In the past, I thought that putting patient mechanical ventilation just for sedation. Actually, it's a painful procedure. Not only just sedate the baby, it's just irritable. No, he is feeling pain. The use of analgesia or sedation of the baby does relieve pain, reduce the catecholamine, and you can observe the patient, once the patient coming from OR, for example, the patient went for surgery, coming down from OR, finds the patient quite tachycardic, maybe hypertensive. Well, of course, secondary to catecholamine release, and patient respond by the stress response. It does do some synchrony. Some babies are quite unhappy about the ventilator and they are fighting the ventilator too much, and bad effects will happen. If he's fighting the ventilator too much, moving too much, air leak syndrome will happen, especially pneumothorax, and maybe catastrophic event. Actually, we can lose a baby simply because this pneumothorax is not adequately managed. And again, about the surge or the fluctuation of the cerebral blood flow, once the patient is sedated, this fluctuation is not that evident to the extent that it affects the baby concerning the interventricular hemorrhage. As we know, one of the common incrementing factors for the development of IVH is the change, the surge or the fluctuation of the cerebral blood flow. With adequate sedation or analgesia of the baby, we are inhibiting this fluctuation and more or less, even from a theoretical point of view, just guarding against the development of interventricular hemorrhage. On the other hand, we're just weighing benefits and hazards. Most of the painkillers can just produce hypotension. And again, we are creating another problem. Other things can produce just bradycardia. Sometimes decreasing the oxygenation. Some of the sedatives like benzodiazepine, lorazepam, or diazepam just displace bilirubin from its binding site. Especially, I'm talking about preterm babies and putting consideration of development of carinic trusts. And so we have to be very careful about the use of these sedatives. Some others can produce paretic ileus and urinary retention like morphia. Some can produce chest wall rigidity like fentanyl. And you can see it many times witnessed just giving one shot of fentanyl, asking the bedside nurse, please just give fentanyl to the baby. I'm trying to just intubating the baby. All of a sudden, just chest wall rigidity is there. And we are in very bad shape at this time. Trying to ventilate the baby, putting bag and mask, but chest wall is quite rigid. And we difficult, actually very difficult to ventilate such babies unless we reverse the effect of this fentanyl with naloxone or something else, and it will take some time. So just be cautious, very important, just not to give this fentanyl in quick push like this. Just give it in the lowest and dose, and it's a very gradual infusion. Here's the different pharmacologic agent we are usually used in. Depends actually on different units. Some do prefer the use of fentanyl, others prefer the use of morphine. Actually, I do like to put morphine before fentanyl, and others use zibutadine or fentanyl. Benzodiazepines, again, like midazolam or lorazepam or diazepam even, and some are using the phenobarbital. I will start just to give a very concise and brief idea about the different opioids we are using. First, we'll talk about, I'll put it in first actually before fentanyl. We do just do prefer actually in our units the use of morphine over fentanyl. I will say why. It is one of the very effective and strong analgesic substance, and it is sedative as well. So we are using it as a sedative and painkiller as analgesic in the meantime. And can be used as supplement to anesthesia even patient going to OR. It is a pure opioid acting with this mu receptor in CNS. We can starting the initial dose by 50 mic per kg. Can give by even by in route, and can be given again every 4 to 8 hours, and titrating according to our to the response. Of morphine, maximum dose reaching 100 mg per kg per dose, and then we can just give loading dose and then continuous infusion later on, ranging from 10 to 50 mg per kg per hour. Adverse effects actually about morphine, it's sharing other opioids or sharing other analgesics or painkillers, they are usually doing the same. It's mainly dependent on the dose, and some complications are dependent on the duration, for how long we are going to use this opioid. Can produce respiratory depression like any other opioids. So actually, it is more or less safe while ventilating the baby. I mean, you're just giving it painkiller post-operative, for example, patient coming from OR. Just be here very cautious about the dose and duration of infusion of such analgesic. But so long as mechanical ventilator, it is not that big problem for us. Drowsiness, bradycardia, and hypotension, again, sharing other opioids versus hypotension. Urine retention and constipation are other side effects, and patients sometimes need for catheterization actually. But with restrictive use and good dose, most of these side effects are avoidable. About the dependence or the tolerance, we can taper the dose gradually after the long term use to avoid this withdrawal signs. And actually, this withdrawal or absence syndrome is not uncommon problem. It's very common we are encountering. Especially patient can develop this dependence very shortly, maybe within the first 24 hours. I do thought before, I did think that it takes very long time for the patient to develop dependence on such opioids, but actually can develop dependence very quick, maybe after 24 hours. For the morphine, it's not that big deal. Maybe with fentanyl, it is more problem, but with morphine, that's why it's one of the preference of morphia over fentanyl about the dependence. It is not a major problem with morphine if compared to fentanyl. And again, with careful use of the dose, I mean, we should use the lowest acceptable dose and producing the best effect and best sedative and analgesic effect of the baby. And gradually tapering the dose, very gradual, not to be abrupt, otherwise these signs of abstinence or withdrawal start to be manifested. This is our second analgesic and painkiller used, fentanyl. Actually, fentanyl is quite potent medication, maybe 20 and some authors, maybe 30 and 40 times more potent than morphine. It's very potent. We're using in dose ranging from 1 to 4 mic per kg per dose, given by push, and even, again, as I said, by push should be very slow pushing, otherwise the main problem I'm telling about is the chest wall rigidity. It's a very common problem, just be careful about this one. It can be used every 2 to 4 hours, and then continuous infusion, we can use it in dose of about from 0.5 to 1 mic per kg per hour, and we can titrate, of course, according to our response. Some babies are responding, and this 0.5, they are completely knocked out. Some other babies are not happy about even 4 mic per kg. It depends about catabolism from one baby to other. In anesthesia, they are usually using quite high dose. You'll be surprised coming from R and giving him maybe 40 or 50 mic per kg. Adverse effects is the same. Fentanyl actually, compared to other opioids or other painkillers, they are the same. Respiratory depression, about cardiovascular problems, and hypertension, and bradycardia. This is the one I'm talking about, the skeletal and chest wall rigidity. Whether it's from memory compliance, it's very stiff chest, can't ventilate at all. Can develop apnea and laryngospasm, and can be reversed by Narcan or naloxone. Here, this is sentence very important about the tolerance and withdrawal symptoms reported with continuous use, and this tolerance and withdrawal symptoms are very evident if compared to morphine. If I'm comparing fentanyl to morphine, it's very evident here with fentanyl if compared to morphine. Period infant and GIT and bradycardia can also occur. Here's some comparison between the fentanyl and morphine. About the potency, I'm telling is a very potent medication, fentanyl. Both are metabolized in liver, both are excreted by the kidneys in the urine. About the onset of action, it's very faster onset of action about the fentanyl, just work very quick. If compared to morphine, morphine a little bit slower in action compared to morphine. Duration of action of fentanyl is shorter duration of action compared to morphine. So morphine has got longer duration of action, so slower onset of action, but longer duration of action. And this is very important, the last sentence, the tolerance can develop very rapidly, as I said, within the first 24 hours. Patient can develop this tolerance if compared to morphine, less potential for tolerance. That's why more or less in our unit, we are using actually morphine if compared to fentanyl. So this question coming again over and over again in our daily practice. Should we use opioids as standard care in our ventilated newborn? I mean, any baby operating in mechanical ventilation should use analgesia, should we use painkiller? What do you think? No. Actually, we put all the time putting a patient on mechanical ventilator, and about to start to think about the use of analgesia or opioids and so, always are weighing benefits against the hazards. If the patient's quiet and calm and is happy about the mechanical ventilation, well and good. If the patient is fighting, I'm anticipating some problems to happen, it is asynchronized with the ventilator, it's coming from R or something, I can just use it, but with very careful, again, about the use it in the lowest dose and for the shortest duration as much as we can. The more you are using actual sedation, the more the baby becoming dependent on these sedatives, and the difficult to wean him even from the mechanical ventilator. And as we heard, I think, from the previous lecture and the coming lecture about the mechanical ventilator per se, I'm starting to think about weaning the baby from mechanical ventilator from the first moment I'm putting on mechanical ventilator. Once I start to intubate the baby and put him on mechanical ventilator, I just start immediately to think when to extubate the baby. The longer, more minutes, not hours, the patient is spending with mechanical ventilator, the more harm I'm giving to the baby, actually, on all levels. A with some cocaine reviews, different sedatives and opioids, and some muscle relaxant as well. This is a cocaine meta-analysis showing that mortality, duration, mechanical ventilation, the cocaine review of mechanical ventilation, long and short term neuroventral outcome showed no statistical difference between the patient using analgesia while they are on mechanical ventilator or those who are not using analgesia at all, using placebo and so. So zero of the mental outcome, long and short term complications, no difference at all. Again, coming back again, should we give opioids to every baby on mechanical ventilator or not?
So, final conclusion, again,
it's
very important.
Weighing the benefits against hazards. Short-term side effects from hypertension, about the longer duration of ventilation, putting the patient on mechanical ventilation, and on the other hand, I think about decreasing the pain score, synchronous about the ventilation, and putting the situation the neurodevelopmental outcome. Either I'm not using the opioids at all, analgesia, pain per se can cause very bad effect on the neurodevelopmental outcome per se in the future. And without the use of with the use of sedatives, the long-term outcome of the use of sedation per se is questionable also and need for further studies. So again, just to summarize this issue, that newborn infants do feel pain. It's a very sensitive creature. Mechanical ventilation is associated with pain, not a matter of just irritation. It is associated with pain. It is painful procedure. Repetitive or chronic pain has long-term effects. So it has effect actually, it does not just not to leave your baby suffering from pain. Analgesia does reduce stress response in this case. But if we use this analgesia, very especially in preterm baby, in hemodynamic and unstable infant, just be very very cautious when you use patient hypertensive baby. Use always the lowest possible and the shortest possible duration. Again, morphine versus fentanyl. It is more or less personal preference, but generally speaking, we do prefer the use of morphine if compared to fentanyl, as we said about the dependence, about the duration of action, and putting in consideration again the withdrawal syndrome. This withdrawal syndrome actually are encountering, especially when chronic ventilated babies. I remember we have one baby with diaphragmatic hernia, and he has got very bad course. You put him in conventionals, in oscillator, and oscillator is very traumatic experience for a newborn, and is operated upon and passed into a lot of complication, and we inevitably we cannot avoid using strong analgesics actually just to keep the baby quite calm and start to complain. We are the one who's suffering later on about the withdrawal symptoms. Patient got very irritable. Once we start to wean him from sedation, start to get very irritable, got very tachycardic and even hypertensive, and we start to fix some problem we created for the baby. So it is not something without problems. This is some protocols adopted by some units to guard against the withdrawal symptoms. Again, this prevalence of opioid withdrawal is greater with fentanyl more than morphine, the same sentence we said about. More than 50% of the opioid withdrawal occur within the first 24 hours. So it's quite early. We think before that it take long time. The units received a minimum of 24-hour fentanyl by continuous infusion, so it developed quite early. Don't think it takes a long time to develop. The most significant risk factor of opioid withdrawal mainly the dose and the duration of infusion. And this is some protocol adopted by some unit for the gradual withdrawal, 20s and 20s and around 10, 8, and eventually 2% of opioid therapy for maybe even 21 days. It actually takes time. If the patient starts to be symptomatic, for withdrawal take a long time actually. Just a few sentence lines about paracetamol or acetaminophen. We are using actually very common nowadays as replacement for these opioids. If we can, if we can get rid of these opioids, maybe the first couple of days, even major surgery actually. It's very effective, paracetamol. We are giving by IV route, and once patients start to treat PONT, we can give it through oral gastric tubes. But we are using an IV in dose range from 7.5 milligram to 10, sometimes 15 milligram per kg per dose, giving you 6 hours. can be used to mild to moderate pain in units, especially in the period after starting to wean him from this period or from this sedation. Peak consultation takes nearly about half an hour to 1 hour, and it's well tolerated and has low toxicity. Some concern about liver toxicity, but actually in this dose we are using, it has a very good safe. I'm going to actually skip the slides about the use of benzodiazepine, diazepam, lorazepam, or midazolam. About the, there's no evidence again to use the benzodiazepine, especially in newborn or in ICU. It's a very effective sedative medication, but again, it's not evidence-based. It has some trials that have been done before to compare the effect of babies, the group using benzodiazepine and the group were not using. Actually, there's no difference at all, either to use it or not to use it, but still actually are using. Just be careful while using in combination with other opioids or other analgesics like fentanyl. Patient can develop intractable hypertension, and some patient can develop just seizure-like activity and actually confuse, especially in small babies. I'm thinking about seizure, can develop seizure anytime, and simply midazolam or diazepam is the one causing this abnormal, and we start to go to another direction. Why is the patient seizing? And I think about hemorrhage and the periodic science. About this little muscle relaxant and paralysis, actually no way for the muscle relaxant nowadays in most of the units, unless you are in desperate situation to use the muscle relaxant like pancronium or something. I remember in some units you have got very high incidence of tetanus neonatorum, and the patient is spastic all the time and moving and so, and you have to knock him out even for more than 1 month with skeletal muscle relaxant like pancronium, for example. In our units, actually, we are not using too much except in very, very desperate situation. We cannot control the movement and the irritability of the patient with this one. Especially in PPHN cases, patient is very sensitive, very susceptible. Any noxious stimuli, even sound or light, can stimulate the baby, and the just saturation just came down. In this state, we can use this rising or under-rising muscle relaxant, but generally speaking, we are not using it. The last part of the lecture now, we're going to talk about the prone position, and we all know about the advantage of this prone position. Why the patient, of course, in the NICU, and to discourage the prone position where the patient is for discharge. It's a very important point because most of the visitors, mothers and fathers, are visiting the babies in the unit and find him in this position. And they got the idea that this is the ideal position of the baby. And if there is adequate teaching of the parents about the hazards of the prone position where the patient in his own home, it will be very dangerous. So just take the chance while the patient preparing him for discharge to teach the patient about the hazards, about the sudden infant death syndrome and other complication prone position while the patient at home. Patient at hospital is a different story or different situation. Anyway, these are the advantages of prone position. It's proved to improve oxygenation and respiratory mechanics, improving the compliance of the lung, increasing lung volume and reducing the repeated lung collapse or atelectasis, facilitates the drainage of secretion, especially with physiotherapy, reducing the ventilator-associated lung injury, and improving the ventilation perfusion. Can use the prone position with the patient on invasive or non-invasive ventilation. Patient with CPAP, we can use the prone position. Conventional ventilator or on oscillator, we can use this prone position. It's the last slide actually about the contraindications. There's actually no absolute in vision neutral in ICU are not facing all these problems to consider it as a contraindication. There's no absolute contraindication to put the patient in the prone position. Some complications may be encountered in prone position. Actually, in our practice, we are not seeing this complication. Good bedside nursing care, good observation of the baby around the clock will avoid all this complication. Sometimes we are concerned about the prone position while the baby has got some UVC and UVC. Central lines are there. Maybe the patient, some leak, displacement of the catheter will be there, and horrible bleeding might take place. This is actually our only concern concerning prone position. Otherwise, no. We don't have any complication. We didn't encounter any complication. And there's no absolute contraindication for our practice in prone position. Thank you.
موضوع pulmonary hypertension. I think we know that from the pathology of pulmonary hypertension, not only the spasm of the smooth muscles in the
pulmon, right.
Spasm and hypertrophy.
Yes.
So how can يعني إمتى نستعمل nitric oxide, because the nitric oxide affect all the
spasm. You are right.
And the hypertrophy.
You are right.
يعني إمتى تشوز دي حاجة. تاني سؤال, إحنا we don't have nitric oxide.
Yes.
Most of our countries. We use sildenafil and magnesium sulfate.
Yes.
You didn't mention magnesium sulfate.
Yes.
As if in magnesium sulfate is mentioned, we could then.
Yes.
Not mentioned.
Yes.
But actually, we use magnesium sulfate frequently, and we did have encouraging results than the other. Magnesium sulfate didn't do much problem like the other.
Okay. About the first question about the use of inhaled nitric oxide. Actually, as I mentioned, I didn't mention, for example, we can use the inhaled nitric oxide in case of diaphragmatic hernia. About the hypertrophy or the modulation of the pulmonary vascular bed in utero, and inhaled nitric oxide will not do any effect. That's why we are not using the compracts in case. Still we are using, but I mean as evidence based to use it in pulmonary hypertension secondary to hypoplasia of the lung, for example, in case of the diaphragmatic hernia, we're not using. But we can use actually in lymphospasm, as you said, about case of meconium aspiration, for example, or respiratory syndrome, severe intractable hypoxia, and so on. So there's no modulation of the blood. There's just spasms there, and we can use an inhaled site. Yes. Yes, as you said, exactly. About the second issue about magnesium sulfate, actually, every unit, actually, even in Saudi Arabia is used in the past, actually, and some units may be still using till now with magnesium sulfate. They have encountered some problems about magnesium, especially in the intractable hypotension, and again, we're starting to think about the use of vasopressors and so, and about the hypermagnesemia as well. We encountered, I remember in the past, encountered very high level of magnesium in the blood and its effect on the heart, on the gut as well. Actually, as a study per se, it will be very good to compare the effect of magnesium sulfate to sildenafil and so. I don't know. We are not using actual sildenafil per se alone as one modality only for the treatment of pulmonary hypertension. Usually it's used in conjunction with inhaled nitric oxide and give actually very excellent results. And we don't face too much problems concerning bleeding with the use of maybe it's a matter of protocol about the dosage, about the use like this. It's a matter of practice, as I said, about the magnesium sulfate. Some units I have been working before we used the magnesium sulfate, sometimes giving some results, sometimes it is not like this. But it is good to carry out this.
Sedative,
not painkiller. Yes.
You mentioned as a sedative.
Yes.
The prone position. Usually say, prone position is not to be used. We're not supposed to be used as prone position. ودايما بنقول back to sleep.
Yes.
خلاص. طب يعني إيه التغيير اللي حصل في الوضع؟ يعني احنا
بنكرر
ان هم
يبقوا
على
بروم
بوزيشن تاني
نوك سوباين. نو وي ار انكرج جيم تو بي ان سوباين بوزيشن.
اه يس.
نو اكشلي اي جاست لا جاست ريبيت ات اجين. موست اوف ذا تايم وي ار nursing our babies in prone position.
Yes.
So parents are coming to their babies, visit their babies, they found them in prone position. So yes. They thought this is the ideal position of the baby. Yeah. That's why we have to start to teach them every now and then, especially prior to discharge, this is not set of position at home. It is set of position hospital, patients monitored all the time, but at home may be very dangerous for them. So back to sleep again. Okay. No questions? Yes.
You could accept some degree of fight, or you might use short duration.
So actually about it is not a matter of just fighting about the change in the twitches in the face, about the blood pressure. We're using a score actually. I mean pain score. And every unit has got its own score to use it. For example, we are using what's called the CRI score. And the bedside nurse has got this list and she's documenting how much this CRI score is out of 10. And once we reach about 4 out of 10, we start to use this MGS. So it is already ordered for her like this. She's assessing the baby around the clock on an hourly basis. And once this CRI score or this pain score reaches level 4 or more, we can start to use analgesic automatically like this. So it's not a matter of fighting or not fighting like this. Sometimes we are just accepting patient fight so long as it's not affecting his saturation. So just moving something temporary. But if he's fighting too much of intensity to the extent that affecting saturation of the baby, for example, we can just give him sedation like this.
Did he use the other modalities
like
Like?
We are using Bosentan, I mentioned. It was the third one, yes. But in the serine receptor, type 1 and type 2, is using Bosentan. Actually, it is not very common in our practice. We are used for some cases. Some cases are very favorable, others are not that good outcome. Okay. Questions?
Yes.